Okay, so it's 1:02, so I guess I'll get it going. Hey everyone, and welcome to the John and Mary Louise Riley Seminar Series. I'm really happy to be able to introduce our speaker, Dr. Kristen Splinter today. We have the great privilege of hearing from her from all the way from Australia, where she's a senior lecturer at the University of New South Wales, Sydney. Kristen received her bachelor's in civil environmental engineering at Queen's University in Canada. Her master's in coastal and oceanographic engineering at the University of Florida, and her PhD in geological oceanography from Oregon State University, where she used remote sensing and imagery to study sandbar migration. Over the past 20 years, Kristen's work has primarily focused on coastal processes, coastal hazards, and coastal structures using physical and numerical modeling, as well as a multitude of unique and innovative techniques in machine learning and AI, and data-driven modeling, and in a really wide variety of remote sensing methods, which is all kind of how I came to know her and her team's work, and is what we'll all be hearing more about today in her lecture titled How Remote Sensing and Big Data Are Changing Our View of the Coast. Before we get started, I'd just like to remind everyone to submit whatever questions you may have in the Q&A function below. And I'll read them off to Dr. Splinter at the end. And with that, here is Dr. Kristen Splinter.
Hello, everyone. Good morning from Sydney. And thank you very much for tuning in with us today. And thank you very much to Will and to the John and Mary Louise Raleigh Bodega Marine Laboratory Seminar Series for inviting me here. So I've got a talk today that will go for, I guess, about 45 minutes, looking at some of the aspects of the work that I do with some of my students recently. Just to give you a bit of context, Will has mentioned that I am coming in from Sydney and I am a lecturer at UNSW, and I primarily spend my days when we're not in lockdown at our water research laboratory facilities, which are located just inland of Manly Beach in our Northern Beaches area for Sydney. And at this time, I would like to just acknowledge that this land is that of the Garamagal clan from the Eora Nation, and they are the traditional owners of this land. And I would like to pay my respects to the elders past and present and emerging from here. So the Water Research Laboratory, for those of you who aren't familiar with it, we are, I think, a fairly unique center in the sense that about 50% of our staff, or roughly sort of 30 to 40 people, are considered academics and or researchers in academia, so our PhD students, honors, etc. And we do work, as you would be sort of familiar with, funded through agencies sort of similar to NSF, as well as industry and government. The other half of our staff are actually consulting engineers, and so they do also lots of practical research funded from industry and government. And you see a few pictures here of some of the wide range of work that we do at our laboratory. And the figure on the far right is one of our big wave flumes with some sand in it. I'll give you an idea of some of the dune erosion experiments that we've got upcoming. And we've done some more in the past. And we're doing a lot of work looking at dam modeling currently, so some upgrading. And I'm involved with some students looking at how we can use technology such as LIDAR to improve our understanding of air water flows over there. And that's all being led by a colleague of mine, Dr. Stefan Felder. As Will mentioned, I have a couple of different research areas, and today the talk is going to focus more on the remote sensing and understanding coastal beach erosion and some of the long-term variability. I also have, depending on the flavor of the month, dabbled in some work in the Pacific Islands, looking at reef hydrodynamics and extreme events, as well as some coastal engineering design, looking at most recently postural stability implications on floating breakwaters. So if you've ever walked out onto a floating pier and felt a little uncomfortable, looking at it from an engineering perspective and how we could possibly improve that for your enjoyment. So today's talk will focus in on the remote sensing aspects work that my group does. And at this point, I'd also like to acknowledge that most of the work I'm presenting here is the blood, sweat, and tears of my PhD and honours students. So in the remote sensing space, you'll see work from Killian Voss and Aaron Doherty, and in the machine learning applications, work from Tom Buse and Josh Simmons, and a little bit from Ray Bassetta as well. And these will all be acknowledged by pictures of them at the top of the slides, just to give them due credit for the work that they've all done. So when Will was asking if I could give a talk on the remote sensing work and sort of machine learning aspects that my team has done, I was reflecting back on a paper we published a couple of years ago in the journal Remote Sensing, looking at the amount of data that we have been able to collect at a single site, so at Narrabeen Collieroy, since we started surveying that beach in the mid-1970s. And you can see on the top of that figure there that there is a sort of stepwise increment in the cumulative data as new techniques come on board. The big ones that were of interest today will be the satellites there in red in the bottom figure. Now those, most of them started the launches in the mid 80s, however, weren't really publicly available for us to use as scientists until more quite recently. And then the Narrabeen Collieroy site has had Argus cameras at it since the mid-2000s. We do a lot of in-situ work with RTK and ATV. But then we also have got into technologies such as airborne and fixed LiDAR, UAVs. Most recently, Mitch Harley has started up a program based on citizen science called CoSNAP. And there are, I think, a number of sites definitely around the US, but in California. So if you ever see a CoSNAP sign, that's your way of being able to participate in more coastal monitoring using your smartphones. So when we think of all the different methods that we can collect data at a beach or along the coast, our group tends to, I think, focus first on what the application is or what's the question that we are trying to answer, and then what is the best technique to be able to capture what we're after to answer those questions. And then also the limits that we have within the technology. So when we started out with something like the emery method, which is just a rod and stick and a measuring tape, very simple, not as accurate, but quite easy to use, and obviously very low data requirements. We could stick the information into an Excel sheet now, but it was written on pieces of paper back in the 1970s. And because of the amount of time it takes to walk profiles at beaches, we didn't tend to do a lot of profiles, but it has formed an incredibly useful and useful data set in terms of our long-term coastal monitoring. So to have data for 40 plus years at a site to understand, you know, climate variability, inter-annual variability due to ENSA, et cetera, has all come out of that work. And there's only a handful of sites around the world that would have similar types of data sets. So you're looking at ones like Duck, North Carolina, out of the U.S. Army Corps. There's a site in Japan, and in the Netherlands would be some of the other ones where we have these established long-term routine monitoring sites. And then you go to sort of the other end with the launch now of satellites, and we have huge amounts of data being available, slightly less resolution, obviously, because these are coming from space. But even that is being tested in some of the launches of the new Dove satellite constellations and whatnot, where we are getting much finer accuracy. But these are also could be used for long-term monitoring because we now have data around the world since the 80s. So it will really drastically expand, I think, our knowledge around the coast. And then when we're going into site-specific ones, such as LiDAR, these can be much more high accuracy. And in the airborne LiDAR space, we were really targeting regional scale dune erosion there. There we go. And so the two that I will focus in on here today will be our airborne LiDAR and some of the work we've done from there, and satellites to keep with the theme of remote sensing and big data. So looking at our LiDAR in terms of our what I refer to local survey techniques that have been going on since the mid-2000s, we've been doing the LiDAR since about 2007, and the real target here was on immediately pre- and post-storm survey data. And the reason for this, if you're familiar with some of the great LIDAR data sets that have come out of, for example, NOAA in the US, GS in the US, these tended to fly after big hurricane events, for example. And so we may have great storm response right afterwards, but the pre-storm data could be years old. And so when you're trying to get a really good understanding of what's driving, different parts, why did one area erode and another part potentially had barrier overwash, having that really good pre-storm data is also equally as important. And so we were flying out or trying to develop systems we could fly at short notice. So we were fortunate at the time in 2011 when we launched this program. UNSW also has a school of aviation. And the head of the school at the time was actually an oceanographer originally from Scripps. And so he had a very keen interest in the land and ocean boundary and was quite happy to cut holes in the bottom of some of their planes and throw some LIDAR and high resolution cameras into the bottom. And in this sense, we could call him up within about 24 hours notice of an event coming, and he could get a pilot up and fly sort of regionally a couple hours north or south of Sydney for us and capture this data both pre and post-storm for us. When we go to sort of the global scale, and I've got this figure here from Killian. So we've got the publicly available images, which are coming out of, these are things we can pull off of Google Earth Engine, for example. And so they're the Landsat missions and Sentinel-2 and the Aster ones. And you can see that those vary slightly in terms of their resolution, in terms of pixel size. So the earlier satellites, each pixel footprint was on the order of 30 meters, and we're still getting a revisit time in that case of about every 2 weeks. Some of the newer satellites and Sentinel, we're getting down to 10 meter pixel size and a much quicker returns into a single space. And so you might be getting data or an image every 5 days, provided it's a nice clear day. I'll also show you one slide and some work we're doing where we're looking at the Planet Labs constellation, and that's got sort of resolution in the 1 to 2 meters. And given that more and more satellites are coming up, we are currently sort of getting an image almost every day at our local beach. So I might try and show you really quickly just an example of some of what this looks like for us. So there is this website, Stuff in Space, that one of my PhD students got me on to. And if this all works for us here, I can pop over and you should be able to see the Stuff in Space website now. And so it's just showing you the world. I've got the Sentinel ones in here. And so you can hopefully see little lines to tell you where the Sentinel satellites are currently. And so those are the ones that are sort of coming by every 5 to 7 days for a certain location. Whereas if we look at, as we were talking prior to this, the Starlink constellations, which has obviously many, many more satellites, you can see just the type of web coverage that these newer satellites are covering the Earth. And so why we can start to get images almost every day, or even in some cases twice a day on here, which I think is just great for our coastal science space. Now, these ones are not free, but maybe in time they will become easier availability to us. So those are the satellite data that I'll show you a little bit on. Now, for the Google Earth Engine, so the free satellite data, Killian Voss, his PhD has been focused on remote sensing and understanding big scale processes. And so the first task he had was to develop some form of a tool to be able to extract shoreline data fairly simply at large scale. So he didn't want to sit here and manually digitize 35 years worth of images at every site he was looking at. So with this was the inception or the birth of CoSat. And that's a freely available tool that's, I think, fairly well serviced and has a growing community on GitHub if you want to use it. And it works on the Landsat and the Sentinel-2 images. And so anywhere they've been you can now sort of extract shorelines on there. And now that gives us 30 plus years of shoreline time series along most of our coastlines compared to the individual in situ data sets that we were relying on prior. And so this should open up a real richness into what we can learn about coastlines on a regional and global scale. Now, the image resolution for these started, I said, our land sets have got about a 30 meter pixel size. With some subpixel imaging techniques, we can get that error down to about 10 to 15 meter horizontal accuracy compared to in situ data for a shoreline position. And to do that also requires information about tides and possibly wave conditions. So just to point out quickly some of the challenge that we have with satellites. So these follow the sun synchronous orbits. And so for nominally most places around the Earth, it means it's taking an image between 9 and 10 a.m. every time it flies over. And so given our tides don't work on a 24-hour cycle as well, that means every time we go and take an image, it's at a different tide stage. And so when we're trying to actually understand how shorelines are varying in time, it would make good sense for us to try and get these all to a fixed elevation and remove that tide signal. So a good example from that is here from Trouquefert. So this is in the coast of France. There's been a number of big experiments that have happened out of here. But here you can see two different images, a high tide one on the left and the low tide there on the right, and giving you an idea of how, you know, easy or clear it would be to pick a high tide shoreline in this case. Nice clear distinction in the NMWDI image there. But when you get to the low tide image, what you can see very clearly from the morphology is the waves are breaking sort of just offshore, and then you've got this really complex intertidal morphology, which obviously has it looks like it has a clear level, sort of small layer of water on top of it. And so our shoreline is being picked out by these automatic algorithms is much less well defined. Now, there's been a recent paper out by Bruno Castell's group looking explicitly how to better estimate shorelines from satellite images at these mesotidal and high tide range sites. So there's been advances in there as well to how to improve it. So I'd encourage anyone working on those types of sites to look up his work. And so we can correct for tides if we know something about the tide range. That also requires us to know something about beach slope, which I'll show you a little bit later. Other challenges we have, because these are instantaneous images, the setup and the run-up from waves also contributes to the uncertainty in the shoreline position relative to a fixed datum. And that's not something we can necessarily control for as well. And most of these images are fairly accurately georeferenced, but that's not necessarily true on a global scale. And we still do see some image wobble. And so if you have something clear in an image that you can sort of pinpoint and then sort of georeference to over time, that can improve your images as well. Now, so we've been starting to look at, I guess, on the success of Killian's work on the Landsat images, trying to start looking at the higher resolution data that's coming out of these Dove constellations, and specifically we're using the Planet Labs data. This one is one of the fee sites. However, for researchers, you can get a limited amount of data download every month. And so we were using that stream to be able to pull data down for the last approximately 5 years at Narrabeen and Collaroy to see how well we could extract shorelines from those images and compare it to in situ data. So the benefits from this data set compared to the Landsat images, again, these are higher resolution, but also both in space, but as in time. And so if you're really interested in knowing something about a pre and a post storm, for example, as you see there on the right, we've got images on a daily basis here. So we can accurately see the shoreline change that occurred over a storm event. Now these have pixel resolutions on the order of about 2 meters. However, we can't get our error down to that level. is an error here in the 4 to 5 meter range. And that's really attributing back to some of these georeferencing of the images, as well as the swash. So wave by wave processes that we just can't sort of account for in the image, but still exceptional data when you consider we can do this, you know, anywhere from a computer rather than having to go out to sites and collect data. And Jaren has put his codes up online as well, and we're hoping to submit a paper on this in the next week or two. So that just gives you an idea of the data that we are collecting, or the data that we are exploiting from other people collecting it for us. And I'll now sort of show some of the work that the students have done in using that data and how we can predict coastal change and variability. And one of the things I like to actually do with this sorts of data is, what can we learn from our models? And so my group tends to interrogate models a fair amount to try and understand their limits, but also pull out processes from them. So with respect to the airborne LIDAR data that we had, the figure there on the left was some work that came from Ed Carney's master's thesis. And he was involved, he was with us at the time when we launched these the airborne LIDAR in 2011. And so the figure here that you can see on your left-hand side, you have the ocean. It's not, I was wondering if I can put a, that's not what I wanted to do, but this might just start subtitles and I'm not too sure how to get out of that right now. So you might have to just bear with me on that. I'm trying to get a pointer up, and I think a laser pointer here, that helps maybe a little, sorry. You'd think a year and a half into remote desktop presenting, I would know how to do some of this a bit better. So this figure here on your left, so we've got the ocean here at the top, the back beach of the dune here at the bottom, and this bottom figure is showing the overall volume change between the two LIDAR surveys that he's plotted here. So created this heat map, but just turned it into a 2D plot instead. So in this particular one, we were able to fly LIDAR every day over a 5-day period and look at how the dune evolved over time, which was really interesting because we could see the very tidal influence of beach erosion occurring. And so really the level or the elevation to which water was getting to the dune quite understandably was dictating the amount of erosion that we could see. At this beach, we typically have a lot of beach cusps, and so you see a lot of patterns of blue and red representing really the washing out of those beach cusps, where we saw sand being deposited in some areas and then eroded off the horns in the other. And then notably here in the center, this darker red section was where we saw the most erosion, and you know, adjacent to it, we see very little erosion at all. And this particular area, when we started to look at the morphodynamics of the dune system, it was particularly low compared to the areas just to the south of it, so here to the right. And so lower dune toes, a narrow beach, really left it much more exposed to larger amounts of the tide range, and so resulted in enhanced erosion. So with this really high resolution data, this was stuff we could start to really look at a bit more with, I would say, more detail and more certainty as to what was driving some of those changes. The stuff work here on the right was stuff that Mitch Harley had led, and he's a senior researcher here at UNSW. And so this was using our regional scale LIDAR. And this plot here is from the 2016 East Coast low event that we had that caused severe damage up and down our coastline. And to East Coast lows are, I guess, similar to what you guys would experience on the East Coast of your nor'easter storms that come in. So things, I think Hurricane Sandy actually was a nor'easter. I could be wrong on that one, but you have a couple of them that come in sort of in that upper US area. So we have this big weather event that came in. The figures here on the the right of this plot. So you're seeing in the blue, these are the wave height distributions over time at three different locations. So Coffs, Crowdy Head in Sydney, but just really showing you regionally the wave climate really didn't drastically change up and down the coastline. Neither did the water level signal. So we really don't get much surge here. This is predominantly going to be tidally driven with a small amount of surge there in green between them. But the big one to focus in here is all the colors that go down the coastline. Red here represents larger wave energy at the coast at the 10 meter contour and larger amounts of volume loss and shoreline change, and blue representing small wave energy and small shoreline change and dune erosion change. And so despite there being relatively uniform offshore wave conditions, we saw very spatially diverse changes along our coastline. Here at Nairobi and Collaroy, we had fairly intense erosion at this site. This is where when it made international news, there was pictures of a pool that landed in on our beach, just due to the amount of erosion. And it was a fairly newly installed pool, I think, within the last couple of years, and the beach had eroded back and taken it out. So for us, the big one here was most of our wave energy comes in from the south or the southeast. And so these beaches here that are more southeast facing are used to seeing larger wave energy. So if you know the right and short scheme, looking at dissipative beaches down to reflective beaches, these will be more in the higher, usually the higher energy intermediate beaches. And so more resilient to bigger storms compared to our east facing and our northeast facing beaches, which don't tend to see a lot of wave energy. So are quite sheltered from the predominant direction we see on the coast. Now, this East Coast low was very anomalous in the sense that it wasn't overly big, but it did come in from the east. And so hence why all of our beaches that were more east facing really got pounded by the waves and saw these larger erosion amounts compared to our southeast facing beaches, which were much more protected from here. So having these immediate pre and storm surveys, we were able to have a really good look at this. And then the survey team actually flew sort of every couple months over the next year to watch the recovery. And Mitch has also reported on that. And we saw sort of similar patterns of recovery based on the predominant wave energy coming in for those beaches, which was really interesting. So in the machine learning space from there, so now we've got these big data sets and Tom and Josh were two of my students who were quite keen on understanding or really trying to see what machine learning could be used to better understand our beach now that we had all this data that came on. And so looking at both time series analysis from some of our longer term data sets, but as well as looking at these large spatial resolution data sets that we have. So one of the first things that Tom wanted to look at is understanding, is there a better machine learning method to understand coastal processes? So is there a clear winner or are they all about the same? And then it really comes down to the user and their own interests. And so he looked at five different types of models. A neural network is an example that's given there. And so you've got a set of inputs that you give that go into the input layer. You define the number of nodes and layers that occur inside in this hidden section of a neural network. And then through a bunch of backwards and forwards propagation, all these weights are calculated internally, knowing something about the outputs as part of your training data set. And then you are left with a nice model that hopefully can predict your validation or your test data set into the same bins in this case. Bayesian networks have been relatively popular in the last sort of 10 to 15 years, particularly coming out of the USGS work with Nathaniel Plant really pushing this about 10 years ago. These are really nice in terms of they're very visual, they're graphical. Networks, and they're based on probability distributions. And so you can see compared to a neural network, the clear sort of dependencies, which are given by the arrows, which says beach volume is going to dictate volume change, as so is wave power, for example. Decision trees are another fairly graphical one we can look at, but these are all based on binary splits of the data and that the model internally figures out to try and come down to the groups that you're looking for at the end. And you can define the number of splits and the number of layers that you'd like the model to go down as well. Now, support vector machines are not one I'm particularly familiar with, but you can, I don't see them in high use, I guess, in our field. And so you may have a data set that looks something like this on the left, which is sort of wave power versus volume. And you can see this is a bit of a dog's breakfast. And so all the colors are intermingled. And so you can do some sort of higher order nonlinear transformations to this data and put it into a new form. And from here, now the data is separable, and therefore we can use this to predict the outcome and then sort of bring it back into the other space. And then the last one, fairly simple, is a K nearest neighbor. And so K being the number of local data points around an unknown that you're using. And we look at, you know, what's the majority vote in that area. And that's what would dictate what that outcome position would be. And so to test these five different models, we used, in this case, I'm going to show you examples coming from the really big regional scale LIDAR data set. And so prior to instead of just feeding everything in, one of the things you usually do is spend a lot of time pre-selecting your data and getting a good idea of what variables you think should be dictating the response. And so going to literature, we can see what other people have seen or used. And so we came up with 14 input variables, 9 of them based on antecedent wave conditions, and then another 5 of them based on forcing. And so that would be sort of driving that change. And so these were our 14 candidate variables. We used a process called tenfold cross-validation. And in this case, we had about 1,800 profiles of data. And so 10% of that is kept away as part of the test data set. The other 90% is used for the training and variable selection process for there. And then you repeat this essentially 10 times for the 10 folds. And then you can get an overall level of accuracy and optimal data sets from there. And so doing this tenfold cross-validation using these 14 parameters and the 5 different models, we can start to look at the overall skill of these models and the variability of that skill. And so the first sort of main point that we came off with was that all the models were relatively the same in terms of their performance. And so this is a figure here showing prediction accuracy versus the machine learning method. And you know, the average here is about 75% in the red. The SVM model does slightly better, but you know, given between 75 and 80, that's not a huge difference for the much more complex type of model to use. And you can see that the range here is based on the 10 folds for each one of them. And so, you know, no clear winner in terms of model. I guess that's not overly surprising. These are all data-driven or machine learning models. The other thing we can start to look at is what were the key variables that each of these models pulled out for each time they ran. So I said, I'm really interested in sort of using these models to better understand the system. And so this is one of the ways we can do it. So we've got the 14 candidate variables on the x-axis here, and selection frequency is the number of times out of the 10 folds that variable was chosen as one for the final model in the test stage, in the training stage. And so when a variable comes out as having a value of 10, it means that it was picked in every single one of the iterations or the folds, and then each one of the colors represents the different type of model that we used. So you can see that profile orientation and beach volume came out all 10 times for all 5 models. And so those are 2 very key morphometric parameters in our data set that were really dictating the observed volume change. And then the one wave forcing parameter that came out the most frequently was wave steepness. And so this is a ratio of wave height to wave length, and came out 10 times during some of the ones, and then some of them as low as 7, but you get the idea that that's the sort of primary forcing term. And so one of the first things that we looked at was, well, what if you tried to run the model with just those three parameters? And that obviously would mean a whole lot less data that we would need to collect and would make a much more simplified model. And so the outcomes from that was we saw a very little change in skill. So here's a plot of the percent difference in accuracy for only using those top three variables. So this is really showing us that those variables are, you know, very much dictating the response that's coming out of each one of those models when we're only seeing a, you know, 2% change plus or minus in terms of the accuracy when we only use those three variables. Now I'm going to flip back and forth a couple of times here. So where Josh was really looking at time series modeling and Tom was doing the dune erosion modeling for a single event. Similarly here, we found sort of a similar outcome in the time series modeling with Josh, in the sense that a neural network that was only given input variables related to the wave forcing, so here's significant wave height and peak period, didn't tend to match the data very well. So the data here in black, and you can see the training and the test data sets here, but it did this wild oscillation really around the data. As soon as we also allowed it to see the previous shoreline position, and in this case, it was the modeled output position that was given, you can see the model now does much better at being able to follow these patterns. So this really agrees well with the equilibrium model work that's come out, I guess from my own group and the shoreform model and Yates's model, where knowing something about the antecedent shoreline position really is important in understanding how the beach is going to change and its resilience to, for example, larger storm events. So flipping back to Tom, the other thing we were looking at was the amount of data. And so data collection can be very time consuming and expensive. And so we had close to 1800 profiles. Well, what if we only had 50% of that data? Would we do equally as well? So, and in this sense, the data that he, these were randomly chosen from there. And so again, you see a sort of equal change in skill as we would had we dropped to only a three variable model. So very small amount of change. And so we could have dealt with having less data. Once we start going to only a quarter of the data, we do start to see a larger drop in the skill of the model, particularly in the ones like Bayesian networks and decision trees. That really rely on, you know, probability distributions and understanding the links between the variables and or data splitting in here. So the more, I guess, simplified models in that sense. And the story obviously keeps going. When you go down to 10% of the data, we can have a loss of skill, you know, upwards of 20 to 25% in some of the models. But overall, some of them, like a neural network model, is still only losing about 5% of its skill when only on 10% of the data. So this would say if you're sparse in data, you might be better off choosing something like a neural network than a more graphical model like a Bayesian network or a decision tree, which really requires more data to understand its splits. So similarly, flipping back to the shoreline one, one of the key things that's come out of Josh's work was, so the quantity of data, which I just showed you with Tom, but the quality of that data, and the quality here I'm referring to is the variance of that data. So I could give, these aren't examples of exactly the same number of data points, but this gives you a picture here on the left, which shows when the variance of the data was quite small, the model couldn't really predict outside of that range. And that's pretty standard for most machine learning models. They don't predict at a sample particularly well. However, when the model was given a wider range of data, it was able to, of course, pick up that range. So from his work, it really, when you're picking the data set, you want to try and pick the one with the biggest variability or range and variance in there to be able to really capture the best probable skill of your model going forward for there. And so if you're going out to collect data, consider collecting data that is unique or variable where possible. Probably we'll skip over the slide, just given the time on here. We looked at the usability and interpretability. So all these models have different timing skills that we need to deal with, the number of parameters. And so depending how sort of user-friendly they would all be. And then also from an interpretability perspective, what if you're going to go present this, I presume I've got a lot of very smart people here watching this talk, but you may all not be coastal experts. And so being able to present a model in this sense, looking at volume, dune erosion change, most of us can graphically understand a model like this, which shows that the first split or the first order difference in this data has to do with the pre-storm volume in here, and then we start to see splits on steepness and orientation. And so the graphical models can be much more user-friendly when you're trying to present your data to either non-experts or people outside your field of research or explaining it to people. One of the other things that Tom looked at was, how do you fit data, and what's the difference between predictive and descriptive skill models? And so we would tend to actually want to have a well-fit model here in the center. And so this generalizes the relationship and then can predict a bit better on the test or the unseen data, where you can overfit your model and so have a really skillful trained model, but it does not do very well when you get out of sample. So I can show you a couple of examples of what those might look like. So here's a Bayesian network model where we were trying to predict shoreline change for a storm. The left showing you the predictive model, so a very simple one, only based on two variables, input variables to predict shoreline change here. And so you can see the description skill, which is the skill from when it was being trained on, versus the test skill, which is your prediction skill, doesn't drop dramatically. Whereas when I go to this more descriptive model here on the right-hand side, where you can see five input variables and a lot more connections, its skill on the training data set has gone up slightly, but its prediction skill has dropped a lot. And so really telling us that we have overfit the model in this case. And so when you're doing variable selection and having a look at the models, you can actually run them sort of equally incrementing, adding more and more variables in, and start to look at the balance between predictive and descriptive skill. So predictive skill models can be really useful if we're trying to understand something about future storm impacts. So looking at this specific example, we can see if I have known inputs here, so an incoming event that has high wave energy and on an accreted beach, I'm most likely to see an extreme shoreline change. And so if I flip back and forth, you can see how the output probabilities have changed due to my now known input variables. And similarly, these types of models we can put in on certain inputs in Bayesian networks, and so that will also update our prediction or our output variable from there, so that can be really nice. And we can also sort of reverse engineer it in the sense where you can say, well, if I want to know what was the input variables that were most associated with the extreme shoreline change. And so we can see that that's usually most of them were in accreted or a highly accreted beach state and were exposed to a high wave energy in this sense. And so you can sort of backwards look at these models as well. So there's the example of the descriptive network there. And similarly, we can look at the output scenarios. So shoreline change as a function of high wave power, large beach width, will tend to result in more extreme shoreline change, and eroded beaches with low storm power will typically result in a lower amount of shoreline change. And so you can really play around with these types of models that way. The last things I'll show you is work here from Killian Voss. And so this is looking at the satellite data that he's been using. And so his focus has actually been on the Pacific Basin. So when I said we needed to create a tool where he could extract large amounts of data, that's sort of the scale that we were aiming at. One of the first things he needed to be able to Hello. Not too sure what happened there.
Hey, Kristen.
Hi.
You're back. You're back online.
I am back. I don't know what happened. I was in the middle of talking and I said, I just got kicked out. Okay. I am back. Hopefully you can still see the screen again then.
Yeah.
Good. Okay. So this is the beach slopes, much louder now too. And so what we were looking at here is the distribution of beach slopes coming from the satellite data for the Southeast Australia and California, so two opposite sides of the Pacific. And then you can also potentially infer grain size distributions or a D50 value really based on that beach slope from a known empirical equation. And so we've taken our estimates of beach slope here to predict a D50. And again, you can see just the comparisons between the two sites. But these are some cool things I think that you can start to look at using these large scale data sets, which I think, Will, you said you may be starting to look at as well. So let us know if you need data. We've mapped a bunch of it already for you if you like. So just going on from there, we can also look at things like beach rotation. So here's some images from Moruya, just to the south of Sydney. And you can see in April 2013, most of the sand was at the bottom of the beach. And then in July 2016, it was at the top on there. And so we can compare that over time in the compared to in-situ data. So Andy Short moved down to this area when he retired in late sort of 2007. And so we've got nice comparison data here, which sort of gives us confidence in that satellite data. Over the time, it said Andy started the survey program at Narrabeen Colliery. So again, we can compare the satellite derived beach rotation index compared to in situ data and see really good agreement, which really gives us confidence to be able to backfill in data at different sites as well. And then start to look at large scale interannual responses sort of on a regional scale between beaches. So when were they possibly coherent? And then at other times we see when they were incoherent. And so beaches doing different things despite being only a couple hundred kilometers away from each other. And so this is stuff that Ray Bassetta is really starting to get into now, looking at it from a New South Wales coastline perspective. And he's testing out a k-means clustering technique to try and understand beach rotation over the last 30 years along this site. So this is still a work in progress, but they're really showing most of our beaches are rotating at an annual cycle due to the variability in the waves, but also some of our longer beaches rotate on a sort of 10-year cycle. And that's really related to the length of the beach and the amount of time it takes sediment to move from north to south and vice versa. So this work is from Killian that's currently in review at Nature Geoscience, and this just sort of gives you a power of what you can do with some of the satellites, I think. So your top figures, so I guess left-hand plots, we have El Nino, right-hand La Nina. The top ones are the boreal winter, so December, January, February, and the bottom ones being all season. And we've plotted the all season ones here because the southern hemisphere tends to be more influenced by the annual wave climate because we have the Southern Ocean down here that blows all year round. And what he's pulled out is the ENSO events. And so you can see here on the eastern Pacific side basin here, a lot of red during El Nino, and so large erosion, very coherent signal along these beaches, including Japan and Hawaii tend to follow here, whereas, you know, Australia predominantly, we're starting to see more accretion during El Nino. And then when you flip it to La Nina, unsurprisingly, this side starts to see accretion or less erosion, and Australia and to some degree New Zealand also starts to see wider spread erosion. So this basin-wide flipping and flopping, Patrick Barnard led a study about 5 years ago showing this behavior, but looking at only a couple of sites where we had long-term in situ data. So this was before satellite data was freely available to everyone. So this is really reaffirming on a much broader scale some of those initial thoughts where we saw this flip back and forth. And of course, to understand that, Killian's been looking at the forcing responses to there. And so you can see here, we've got wave energy flux and the red or blues indicating that it's significant compared to the grays being it's not a significant change in wave energy flux. And so we see significant increases in wave energy along the US, Mexico, Peru, and Hawaii during El Nino events. And then flipwise on La Nina, we see it here in Australia come through, but we don't see necessarily a significant decrease in wave energy along here, despite seeing an accretionary response in the beach at that location. But we can also look at the water levels. And so unsurprisingly, we see large positive water level anomalies along this side of the Pacific Basin during El Nino. And we see a strong negative water anomalies here during La Nina events. And so this is also contributing to the shoreline response that we're seeing over time at these two areas. So hopefully that paper will make it through the review process, and we can share more about that in the coming month or two for there. So that's the end of my technical talk. I've got three or four just really shameless plug slides for everyone. If you're unfamiliar with it, I'm one of the, I guess, sort of executive members of our Women in Coastal Geosciences and Engineering program that was launched at ICS back in 2016. So we're here to support and inspire women in coastal geosciences. So it's open to all and encourage you to join on there. We also run a coast-to-coast Zoominar, not on the Women in Coastal Geosciences, but Ana Via Cancheo and Giovanni Coco and myself started this up. We run those every 2 weeks, and just like this seminar, we run them on Zoom and are recorded, so feel free to join those if you like. And Anna and Giovanni recently started a podcast called Coastal Cast, where we are interviewing a number of our marine colleagues over time. And the very last one is, if you're interested in coming to Sydney, I can now announce very recently ICC 2022. Borders hopefully will be open for us by then. Please feel free to come and join us. So with that, I will take any questions, and thank you very much for your time, and apologies on that blip where I fell off the screen and came back again.
Thanks so much, Kristen. That was awesome. Some really cool work to see. I'd like to remind everyone, if you have any questions, just to throw it in the Q&A function below. I had some questions while people do that. Just for more like a grander scale, when you guys see those large events, how long are those recovery scales like? And like, let's say like there's not another large event like following them, like is there like an accretion effect, or is it still fairly
cyclical? So you're referring to the like the 2016 LIDAR data that I was showing you? Yeah. So we did fly, and this Mitch was leading this work, but they flew LIDAR, I think, 3, 6, and 9 months was the last time I saw him present on that. And this was a while ago. But it was a bit of he referred to it as a tortoise in the hare response. And so beaches that actually had eroded a lot were quicker to recover, particularly if they were a bit more south facing, where we saw more typical wave energy come in, because that had that higher energy to move the sand back on shore. And then the beaches that were less eroded and the ones that were not seeing as much wave energy afterwards were slower to recover. But over a 9 month period, most of them had made a fairly significant recovery to pre-storm levels for us. And in some cases we get sort of minor storms every couple of weeks to months here. And so you did sort of see a bit of a zigzag as well. So beaches that had accreted quickly, potentially then eroded back again a little bit, depending on the next survey, if a storm had come through again and then come back. So, but overall, we see fairly good recovery on most of our beaches here. Most of our erosion is limited to the beach and the dune system. We don't tend to see like overwash events like you'd see in the Barrier Islands on the southeast of the US.
Cool. Also, I had a question about your slide about dropping some images so things are more manageable. And is that like kind of like a supervised process, or is that like a random process? Because like following those slides, you're talking about overfitting. I could see like you have like such a different variety of different types of photos that might like overfit models or something. I don't know.
Yeah. So in Tom's work, it would have been, in his case, he would have just been dropping a certain percentage of the data. And so he wasn't necessarily trying to drop it uniformly. He was just pulling out 50%, but he would have ran it sort of 10 different times. And so he would have dropped out 50% of data 10 different ways in that sense, and had to look at that variability that occurred with it. But the point where what Josh was showing, it is quite important that when you're looking at what data you have, what's the range of data that you've kept. And so the more diverse your data is, the better it is to be able to understand and learn the bigger processes and systems, possibly, where if all your data had the same uniform response. So if we only kept all the beaches that really highly eroded, for example, well, then the model would have never learned that some beaches actually who were exposed to very similar wave energy, but were a different orientation, it wouldn't have learned that that was a key driver, possibly, in understanding that those beaches don't erode. So yes, it's really important in what data you keep, more so, I think, than the amount of data that you're keeping.
Cool. That makes sense. Great. Well, I think if people have questions, this is a lot of information to take in. There's a lot of really cool, diverse bodies of work. I'm sure Kristen would be happy to respond to any questions you might have over email.
Yeah, please do.
And great. Yeah, I want to thank you again so much for coming today. It's been an awesome opportunity to have you.
Thank you very much, Will, for hosting me and for the wider community there at your lab. So, and I look forward to having a chat with you again soon.
Yeah.